In today's video, we're gonna watch a smart line against the Nimso-Indian defense. The Nimso-Indian defense is one of the most trusted black openings, and I think all the recent world champions have had it in their repertoire. So it's an opening you can get a lot with white. And a lot of players base their repertoire on meeting d4, c4, knight c3 with the Nimso-Indian, and against knight f3 they have all kinds of things like Mud and Benoni, Semislav, Vienna, you name it, it's Ragosin, all kind of stuff, but they all rely on the Nimso-Indian. So today we're going to look at a very dangerous line that Fabiano Caruana used with great effect in the recent World Rabbit Championship. And we're going to see the game he won against Vidit, and we're going to look a little bit at a game he plays against Duda, where it was a draw, but I think I have an improvement for white. So this is a complete repertoire against the short castle variation, more or less. Not complete. Anyway, let's get on with it. Caruana is white against Vidit, a strong Indian grandmaster. Also a famous, I think, Twits guy. Anyway, and this is the Nimso-Indian, and this is Queen C2, and it's a clever move. It's basically white is ready to take back with the queen on C3 and avoid the dreaded double pawns. And we know, like I've talked about in other videos, that double pawns become weaker the further they advance. Okay, the main line here is castle, and that's what we're going to look at. There are other lines. C5 is a possibility, and I would recommend that you play this move, and this has scored pretty well for white. These kind of hedgehog structures are supposed to be nice for white. Another line is d5, and that will be in another video. I think white has two choices. He can either play a3, or he can play c takes d5. Both are rather interesting. I think c takes d5 is the sharpest option, and you will follow with bishop d5. Your kingside kind of may remain undeveloped, but you get some sort of a Carlsbad structure with some benefits to it. Anyway, castle is the main line. Black has very speedy development, and here they used to play a3 all the time. Black will take, and you can say that white got the bishop pair for free, but it's not completely free because black's got quite a big head start on the development and can use that to develop some initiative and get some more space. And in general, it's considered nowadays that black is fine after a3, but it's of course interesting, and if you love the bishop pair, maybe this is the line for you. But queen c2 also does something else. It prepares e4, and that is the interesting move here. This is the sharp option. Just taking space, and of course if black takes here, white will take back with the pawn. He has to, otherwise he loses here, and you get the double pawn. But this is a very improved version of the Semis variation, where you didn't spend the time playing a3 and you got e4 in one go and so on. So this is not what black generally would like. The main move after e4 is d5, and black, white of course go e5, and we see this structure here with the pawn on e5 is sort of always a prelude to a white attack on the king. White is hoping to attack the king. Basically, in one move, he will have a serious threat against this pawn down here. And something like this and here can also be a strong attacking force. So black has to be careful here, but black is ahead in development. White is spending a lot of time moving the pawns. Black has already castle and so on. So this move makes a lot of sense. Just getting the knight into play, and it of course cannot be taken due to the pin here. Bishop d3 makes sense, just attacking the knight one more time. c5 also makes sense, just pushing on in the center and trying to explode it into white's head. White keeps developing, and this is all very sharp. And here there are many options, but the main line is and notice that this battery is a bit annoying for black, because he would sort of like not to have to take back with the pawn on d5. Knight d7 is the main line, both eyeing this pawn, but also getting ready to play knight c5 and put support to this knight and attack this bishop, which is of course the good bishop for white. Bishop f4, preventing all kinds of nonsense with the pawn here. And here the main line is queen h4, and that's we're gonna look at first. That's what Vidit played, and was duly crossed. This looks kind of nice. This is kind of move you like. You attack the bishop and you defend the pawn. So and you develop the queen and so on, and there might even be sometimes be something here. So this is a kind of nice move, but and notice the bishop d3 is very bad. You just take it, and the knight is hanging on d4. So d3 is forced, queen h5 is also and castle, and this is all scary theory, but this is clearly the main line, and it goes like this. Have to take here, and actually black has to be pretty careful what he is doing here, because he might actually fast end up with less development than white, and there are some tricky things. It's not so easy to win material, and this bishop down here can easily become bad in all sorts of structures, and you can also get problems on the black squares. The main line here for black is g5, been played in many games, but it's not scoring very well. This is the main move he takes. And here, so far, white has played e6 and has not done badly, but not fantastic either with e6. And then some smart guy realized that you could just play bishop e3, and that this move is really weakening white position. It looks like it just loses a pawn, but after this move, f3, attacking the knight, preventing any kind of stuff on the king side. And we see that there's a big hole here. And after something like this, and here black has two options. He can go to d6 or c5. This has been played, but it turns out something like this is just... You do like this, and white is just clearly better. The structure on black's kingside is a disaster. Vidit went to d6, also clearly the most played moves. And here, and it looks kind of counterintuitive, but white just plays and this move. And this is the key. This is the key to the position. Just making sure this pawn does not move, making sure this square, oh, we should make it red, is weak forever, and taking away squares from this bishop that is not very good. And after this move and take, and this position is interesting. It's been reached in like 20 recent games, and white is just clearly better already. To be honest, if black does not play, the threat, by the way, is this move, hitting here and here. If black does not play rook f7 here, he's more or less lost. Vidit didn't play rook f7, and it's kind of funny he went to this, played rook e8, and here white is winning if he finds the right move. And the right move is here. And what's the idea? The idea is simply to kick the knight, and then white's knight is coming, and that's is gonna hurt. And it's coming here, knight b5, threatening a very, very unpleasant jump here. And notice how this piece is dominated by these pawns. The knight cannot do anything. The black squares is just a mess, and white's position is strategically winning, even though it's equal material. It's kind of interesting, isn't it? So rook f8, bishop here, attacking the bishop, and yeah, it's not fun anymore. White is just going to put his rooks in the center, winning something. And this is already threatening nasty stuff here, and a big invasion. And how to develop here? If you go put the bishop somewhere, then comes knight c7. So a knight c7 is the threat. b6, rook d4. There's also another way to get to the king, and this is I love these kind of things when the dark squares just means that white will you'll have a free way for your attack. g5, totally desperation. Rook f4 check was followed by rook e7 is more or less mating. And trying to get pieces out, check. And here, there is a nice little things. There is actually forced mate in, I think, four moves or something. Rook e6 and Vidit resigned. The finish could be something like this. And mate. Okay, so that was nice. So what's to remember here? It's that after this move, kind of a novelty, is the key. And I think black is already in serious trouble here. This position is more or less unplayable for black. He just has all the weaknesses, all the problems, and black and this bishop on c8 will never be good. The queen can easily get into trouble and so on. So this position is bad for black, and many players have went for it, like 20. So I don't know why they did that. Apparently it was not known. So what to do instead if you're black? After this move, in a later game in the same tournament, Jan-Krzysztof Duda played this move. And that's probably better than queen h4. Makes a lot of sense. And after this move, the game went like this. Castle makes a lot of sense. So, and look, it was white was behind in development, and now he catched up. He's got all his pieces out now, and black's bishop here still has problem getting into the game. And what can you say about this kind of position? The interesting thing here is the opposite colored bishop. This versus this. That means that the black squares can be very interesting for white pieces. The black squares are squares like this, this, and here, and here, and here. So white is looking for an attack on the black squares and trying to play sort of around the white squares. Of course, for black, the complete opposite is true. He's trying to start something funny on the white square. Here, queen takes is necessary. If he takes with the pawn, then knight c6 and queen takes d5 is good for white, I think. I haven't studied. Queen d5, and here Caruana played c4 against Duda, and after knight c5, black was definitely fine and had no problems. So he was just getting active, have good pieces, no weaknesses, and so on. Instead of c4, I think improvement is rook d1. An improvement on existing theory, new move, rook d1, covering the queen. And after bishop here, c4, there's no more knight c5. Because you just take the queen, because your queen is now covered by the rook. And this is basically you don't want to exchange queens in this position with white unless you get a dominating position. So after c4, he has to go with the queen, and it has to go somewhere smart. He's a bit afraid of an invasion along the d file. So queen d7, knight b5 is probably bad. White is definitely having an initiative here with the black squared bishop. So queen a5 is computers. But I think after this move, I think white is probably better. This knight is a bit unstable. The queen is not that good. Yes, I don't like this pawn structure here, but white does have clearly more active and dominating pieces than black. So I would prefer to be white in this position after knight b5. It's not a big advantage, it's a slight advantage, but it's definitely something you can notice for. So quick recap, queen c2, and after castle e4, and then just watch the video a few times and do some analysis for yourself, and you're ready to beat the Nimso-Indian. This was DM Talks. Thank you for watching.